So hopefully you've had a chance to tackle these four problems, and let's go ahead and take a look at what the answers should be. So for the first question, we have a father and a mother who are heterozygous. And remember, heterozygous means you have two different alleles, in this case, big F, little f. And if we put these together, we can figure out all the possible combinations. And then the question is, how many of these individuals have freckles? And the answer is going to be 75%. Notice these individuals have freckles. These individuals don't, but then these individuals, 50%, will end up being big F, little f, heterozygous. They have freckles, but they are carrying one allele for freckles, one without. So there's a few things I want you to notice here. Again, we have a father and a mother with freckles. 75% of their kids would be expected to have freckles, 25% no freckles. This is just percentages, though. So they could have four kids that all don't have freckles. It's just a chance estimate. For question number two, we have a father that's heterozygous and a mother that's homozygous dominant. And again, we put together the possibilities. So now we look at the results and we see that all 100% of these kids will have freckles. So mom and dad had freckles and all the kids had freckles. Half of them are homozygous dominant and half would predict to be heterozygous. In example number three, the father is heterozygous and the mother is homozygous recessive. And we look at the possibilities and we end up with 50% of the kids having freckles and 50 not. And notice in this example, dad has freckles, mom doesn't, and half of the kids have freckles, half don't. In our last example, dad is homozygous recessive and mom is homozygous dominant. And we look at this combination, and again, 100% of the kids have freckles, even though dad didn't have freckles. But now all of them are going to be carriers of the recessive allele and the dominant allele. So hopefully you can see with Punnett squares, there's a lot of different questions you could ask. You could ask what percent of kids have the recessive allele. You could ask what percent have a heterozygous genotype. There's a lot of different questions you can ask from these Punnett squares. I want to talk now about a more serious example. Freckles, it really doesn't matter if you have freckles or not. Cystic fibrosis is a disease that can be fatal, and it is due to one single gene, the CFTR gene. If you have a functional version of this gene, you are able to pump salt through cell membranes effectively. If you have a non-functional gene, that protein isn't able to pump salt. As a result, mucus builds up outside the cell membrane and it can prevent other things, important things, moving in and out of the cell and also trap bacteria and other pathogens and lead to other kinds of illnesses. If you are big F, all of your proteins work just fine and you don't have the disease. If you are little f, none of your proteins can functionally pump salts and you have all the symptoms associated with the disease. 10, 15 years ago, people with cystic fibrosis could only live typically until 7 to 10 years old. With additional treatments and the hope that we've figured out some gene therapy ideas for this, people are living into their 20s and 30s, and hopefully we'll continue to improve the outcomes for people with cystic fibrosis. If you have big F, little f, you don't have the disease, you don't have the symptoms, but you are considered a carrier for the disease. So the big F is dominant, and it turns out if only half of your proteins are the correct shape, you can still clear enough mucus away that you're not going to have significant side effects on the body. But now you're going to pass those along. So someone who is a carrier is someone who is heterozygous for a disease with a recessive allele. So they're carrying the disease without having any symptoms. And I want to go back to that same set of Punnett squares you just did, and let's look at them thinking about cystic fibrosis rather than freckles. So here we are back to these four Punnett squares, and here we have a father that's a carrier and a mother that's a carrier. And so notice neither of these parents have cystic fibrosis. They might not have any idea that you're a carrier, but they have a 25% chance of having a child with cystic fibrosis and a 50% chance of having children that they will also be carriers as well. If we look at this next scenario, here mom is not a carrier, but dad is a carrier. If we look at the possible combinations, none of the children will have cystic fibrosis, but 50% of the children will end up being carriers. In scenario three, we have the father as a carrier and the mother actually having cystic fibrosis. And if you follow this through, 50% of the kids would have cystic fibrosis and 50% would be carriers. Another scenario down here, mother is homozygous dominant, father has cystic fibrosis. Notice none of the kids would have cystic fibrosis, but they would all be carriers. Now, these two scenarios are unlikely to happen because until recently, individuals who actually have cystic fibrosis, like this individual and this individual, would never have the opportunity to reproduce. Now, if you know that you are a carrier or it's in your family, sometimes people will opt for in vitro fertilization where you can actually look at the different embryos and figure out if they have the disease or not, and then only selectively implant the ones that do not have the disease. So this is an example of how you can be a carrier, how a disease can stay in a population, and then just show up very occasionally. There are a few examples of dominant diseases where if you have the big F, you have the disease. But hopefully, if you look at this, you can see that that wouldn't persist very long in a population because so many individuals would have the disease and very few would survive. So a pedigree is going to show genetics through multiple generations. And specifically, it's going to show phenotypes and genotypes through multiple generations. So when you're reading a pedigree, a circle is female and a square is male. And if something is filled in, that means that that individual has the recessive phenotype. So we can go in detail and look at a pedigree and actually fill out information. So let's look at a simple example. And again, we'll use freckles. If something is filled in, we know that this individual does not have freckles, and so we know that that's little f, little f. And this individual is also not going to have freckles, little f, little f. And in fact, we can go through this whole thing, and everyone who's filled in, if we know their phenotype, we also know their genotype. What's interesting is to try and figure out the next individuals. So here, they could be big F or big F little f. And you might think, oh, we won't be able to figure that out. But you can actually use the next generation to figure out what's going on with the previous generation. So in this case, this grandmother and grandfather had one, two, three kids, and one of their kids had no freckles. So you can look at a Punnett square of this and this, or this and this, and realize the only way that you could end up with this son is if this grandfather was heterozygous. And so we can eliminate this possibility. Once we know what the father and mother are, in this case, we can assign that this individual has to be heterozygous, and we also know his sister would have to be big F, little f. Now we're going to move over to this side, and again, we want to figure out if they are homozygous dominant or heterozygous. All of the kids have freckles, and so we can't actually determine just from what we're looking at here if we can cross any of these out. We can determine, however, because grandpa is little f, that all of these guys must be heterozygous. And we're going to confirm that because when these two had a child, one of them was also homozygous recessive. This individual, again, because of mom, has to be heterozygous. And then these two individuals, we can't make a determination right now. We're going to need to wait and see if they have kids and what those kids come out as. So when you look at a pedigree, you're really looking at a series of Punnett squares and you're working forwards and backwards to eliminate possibilities and then figure out genotypes. I always joke that it's sort of fun to look around at your extended family next time everyone gets together and start to create your own pedigree of some of these characteristics. Figure out what's being passed down and who has what.